Alan Jackson just averaged a little over 18 yards a carry.
Is that all?
That was it.
Tell you what, I believe the second best performance in school history as far as a running performance. Of course, pretty hard to touch the school record for yards in a single game. I believe 273 by Greg Solomon down at North Allegheny.
Mm-hmm.
And
we were there.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I wasn't,
no,
though.
No, you were off.
That's right. I was in a wedding that day. That's right. I'm trying to think that game. That was a game the Canes were down like 17-0, come back and won 24-17,
right.
Wasn't it?
That's right.
All right, I see. That's right. Now I remember. I missed it. I thought I was there for that.
No, myself and Mr. Hazen were down there.
What a ball game that was, though, last night in Alan Jackson. Outstanding performance, and it won't be easy, but next week, that's for sure. Central Catholic, who was beaten by Butler 9-7, so the Golden Tornado, obviously, with another strong ball club this year.
Coach, the coaching staff down there.
There's pattern change. Go ahead.
Yeah, a little bit of sandbagging down there because the Golden Tornadoes were reported to be not as strong as in past seasons, and with their victory last night over Central Catholic, that might be a little bit of a surprise.
Well, Mark, last week when Shenango came out, the offense did a good job, went down the field and scored a touchdown, and hopefully that offense can do the same tonight, the starting offense for the Wildcats.
Absolutely, Ken, and of course the leader quarterback, 5'9" junior William DeCarbo. They'll be calling the signals once again, and then be flanked by running backs Jim Valeni, 6'1" junior, Ron Iwanico, 5'11" junior, and Alex Keddie, a 6'1" junior. Tight end Rob Creasy, 6' junior, and split end John McCormick, he's a 6'1" senior. Offensive line in the middle, it's Matt Fiola, he's a 5'9" senior, then Steve Throwback, 6'1" junior. Chris Kobe, the left guard, 5'9" senior. Mike Walczak, 5'8" junior. And Brian Purdue, a 6'1" junior.
Okay, we'll give you the, and I believe, who won the toss, Eddie? Who was,
Cornell won the toss.
Cornell won the toss, okay. So we'll also be giving you, let's give our listeners two marks, some of the names that they'll hear for the Cornell Raiders here tonight. Offensively, since they'll have the football.
When you started off with the Cornell Raiders, Paul Leitner, the quarterback, he's a 6-foot senior. Leitner, a second team, section two, all-section player last year. He's going to put the ball up in the air. Rob Stevenson will be getting the ball. He's a 5'9 sophomore. Also, Chris Connor, 5'8 sophomore, will be doing some of the running for the Cornell Raiders. Tight end number 24, Mark Neely. And the split end, the guy they'll be looking for, Dan Whitley. He's a 5'11 junior.
Okay, we'll give you that Wildcat defense as soon as we get set here for tonight's ball game. Officials for this evening's contest.
And officials, of course, from the Lawrence County chapter. The Reverend Fats Cabellis will be our referee. Chuck Dess, the umpire. Dr. Don Hannon, the head linesman. Line judge Don Nogan, and the back judge, of course, Steve Fee.
Rob Stevenson back deep, flanked by Mark Neely and also Paul Leitner. So that's interesting. Got the quarterback running back kickoffs.
That's very unusual.
Walczak has it teed up. Cats going left to right in your radio dial. Good kick. Leitner will get it at about the 20-yard line to the 25. Looking for some room. Leitner to the 30, to the 35, and he's hit right there and brought down. Across the 35 to about the 36-yard line. Vincent Martwinski in on the stop mark. And that was a player that Frank Bonjovingo on our pregame show blotted that he thought played an outstanding ball game. And Martwinski, of course, only a sophomore.
Martwinski did very well against the run. Had one problem on a pass play, but other than that, Vince Martwinski had an excellent game defensively for the Shenango Wildcats last Saturday.
Wide receiver here to the near side. We'll get that Shenango defense set for you shortly. Matt in motion from right to left. Leitner drops back, pass incomplete over the middle, intended for number 20, Chris Connor. And the pass goes incomplete. So on the first play there, pass falls incomplete for the Shenango Wildcats. And it'll bring up Cornell Raiders. It'll bring up second and 10 for Cornell. Just underway, no score. Tell you what, there's some LBSs in this press box now tonight, I'll tell you that. Receivers of both sides, Connor coming in motion here to the near side. Leitner, handoff it goes, breaking a couple of tackles. Is Stevenson, and he'll get to the 40-yard line. Strohecker in on the stop for the catch. It'll gain a five, bring up a third and five.
Tell you what, Kenny, set the front line of the Shenango Wildcats. Front four, Mike Strohecker, a 6'1 junior. Chris Kobe, a 5'9 senior. Ben Pokesaw, a 5'11 sophomore. And Brian Perdue, a 6'1 junior.
Man in motion here to the near side. Again, Leitner, throw, being pressured, pass is caught for a first out of the 50 to the 45. Inside cat territory. That is number 21, Sam Smith, tackle made by Chris Johnson. So Chris Johnson makes the stop. Bring up a first and 10 for Cornell. Nice pass by Leitner.
Absolutely, he was right in, had the receiver right in the open slot in the defense. Johnson came over with the coverage, but a little bit too late. First down, Raiders.
As they come out of the huddle once again, receivers of both sides this time. Connor in motion to the far side. Pitch it comes to Stevenson, looking for some room around right end. Cuts it upfield, but he'll get a couple of yards. Nice play by Alex Keddy, number 47, the 6'1", 175-pound junior, Mark.
Keddy with excellent pursuit on the play. Also, Ron Iwanico over there as well to add some help on the tackle. And small gain for the Raiders, just to pick up a few on the last
pick
play.
Pick up two, and it'll bring up a second down at 8 for Cornell. Wide out here to the near side is Sam Smith. Man in motion again, Connor to the near side. Leitner, quick drop pass is incomplete. Way over the head of the intended receiver, Chris Connor. But Connor appeared to have a couple of steps on that play. Fortunately, the pass went incomplete.
Tell you what, Kenny, see a couple changes in the Shenango defense as far as William DeCarbo was playing a corner last week. He's back at the safety position now. Also, another number in the lineup is number 20, Chris Johnson. He's in at a cornerback. And also see Andy Jensen. He's in at a linebacker position for the Shenango Wildcats.
Glad you told me that. Now I could write his name in. Third down and 8. Quick drop, Leitner, pass to the near side, caught again. That is Smith for a first down, tackle made by Chris Johnson. And that's enough for a first down, game of about 12 on the play.
Enough for first down,
and I'll tell you what, Kenny, if Coach Bongiovingo is talking to the linebackers right now, as a couple of the outside linebackers for the Shenango Wildcats not getting over quick enough, especially getting those backs out of the backfield and not getting over to help out the defensive backs on coverage.
Ball resting at the 27-yard line at a first and 10 for Cornell. Wide out to the far side again is Smith. Connor in motion from left to right. Leitner, handoff, just a couple of yard gain that time by Rob Stevenson. Good tackle by Ben Poza, the 5'11", 180-pound sophomore.
Shenango's had excellent defense against the run. Gave up a couple big runs last week, but then tightened up a lot. And they've stopped the run quite well here this evening, but going to have to work on the pass defense.
No wind at all tonight. It is calm and quiet here at Glen Pop Johnson Field, and another gorgeous evening for high school football. Sam Smith split wide to the far side. Leitner directs some traffic. Also, that's Witte wide to the near side. In motion is Connor from left to right. Leitner drops, throws, pressured, eludes one. Cat, pass him incomplete, batted in the air. And the pass goes incomplete, intended for number 24, Mark Neely.
Tell you what, Kenny, excellent pressure for the Wildcats coming from one of the linebacker positions. Jim Valeni was right in the face of Leitner and forced Leitner maybe to throw the ball a couple seconds too early.
8 minutes and 40 seconds left to play here in the first quarter, just underway from Glen Pop Johnson Field. Kind of a Sparks crowd on hand here tonight. Smith wide to the far side. Backs are split behind Leitner. Now man in motion from left to right. Leitner looks, rolls, pass, caught. Stevenson breaks one tackle, breaks another tackle, still on his feet inside the 20, and maybe close to first down. He's going to be stopped just short, I do believe. Iwanico in on the stop.
Jimmy Valeni had a chance to make a short pickup. It's fourth down, and it's about fourth and 3. Pick up a 4 on the last play. And as I said, Valeni had a chance to make a stop, but bounced right off him and picked up about another 3 yards on the process.
It'll be interesting to see this call, Martin, because of the fact Cornell has not had a lot of success on the ground here in short yardage situation. Receivers of both sides and backs are split. Man in motion from right to left. The pitch comes to Stevenson here on the near side. Stevenson tries to get outside, does first down, 15-10-5. He will score. A 20-yard touchdown run by Rob Stevenson at the 7:51 mark, and some poor tackling that time by the Wildcats. A couple of Wildcats had a chance to bring Stevenson down, but unable to do so.
Chris Johnson got knocked out of blocks. Excellent block by one of the Raiders. And also William DeCarbo came up from the safety position to try and make a stop. He just missed Stevenson into the end zone for a touchdown.
I tell you what, Frank's got a couple of sophomores playing at defense tonight, Mark. Johnson and Jensen. So that may be tough, too. Whistle, we've got a flag on the play.
I believe somebody lined up offsides, Kenny. And we'll see who it was.
But you have Andy Jensen. And it's going to go against Cornell. Andy Jensen in the 5'9", 140-pound sophomore. Meanwhile, Chris Johnson stands at 5'7", 130. He's also a sophomore. So you got a lot of inexperience back in the defensive backfield for the Cats.
And I believe Cornell's going to call a timeout.
I tell you what, I hate that more than anything. when you call a timeout on an extra point, I don't know. It could prove to be an important play maybe later on in the football game. Now the Westminster Titans winners earlier this afternoon start off right under their new head coach.
Absolutely. The West Virginia Wesleyan, 17-10, gets new head coach Gene Nicholson, his first win as the head coach of the Titans, and looking for another great season of Westminster football, and see how far the Titans can get through the season and then into the NAIA Division II playoffs.
Some close games this afternoon, huh?
Yeah.
Penn State winning 81-0 over Cincinnati. I thought that might have been a misprint or something, but it was not. Notre Dame, of course, the winner this afternoon. Ohio State defeated Arizona. As we told you, Penn State a winner. Pitt, winner over Southern Mississippi. Receivers of both sides, 7:51 to go. This is for the two-point conversion. Connor in motion. Leitner drops back to pass over the middle. Caught. Two-point conversion is good to Mark Neely. Officials time, 7:51 to go in the first quarter with the score. Cornell 8, Chenango nothing. Now this on 1280 WKS2. Here in the first quarter, so Cornell takes the football down on their first possession. That's a Stanley. Don't worry, that won't break. Hey, Paul Harvey advertises that one, so it's got to be good, huh?
Cornell gets the ball, moves it right down the field, and see what the Wildcat offense can do here.
All right, Leitner, the kicker, and it's going to be caught by one of the Cats, 25-30. Still on his feet is Iwadiko. Ronnie Iwadiko taking it out to the 40-yard line. So good field position. William DeCarbo, the junior quarterback. Backfield of Jim Valeni, Ron Iwadiko, and Alex Ketty. Split end is John McCormick. The tight end is Rob Creasy. Center is Matt Fiola. The guards, Mike Walczak and Chris Kobe. And the tackles are Steve Troback and Brian Perdue.
Tell you what, Kenny, see if they can get Alex Ketty some carries tonight. As Ketty didn't get a lot of action last week, and we know Ketty can be an explosive back.
DeCarbo under center. Iwadiko in the slot to the right. Cats trail at 8-0. Long count by DeCarbo. Hand off and breaking a couple tackles. Picking up a couple of yards on the play will be Jimmy Valeni. In on the stop for the Raiders. Number 35, Greg Pulford, and number 66, Chris Stone. Gain of 2, second down and 8.
Chris Stone got a hand on the ball carrier, Valeni, just at the line of scrimmage. Valeni able to dive forward and get a pickup of 2 on the play.
McCormick wide to the near side. Iwadiko again in the slot. That's strong formation to the left for Chenango. Iwadiko in motion. DeCarbo, handoff it goes. Kenny breaks a tackle. 45, wasn't able to keep his feet. Gets out to about the 48-yard line. Alex is able to keep his feet. He may get about 5, 6, 7 more yards out of that play. But still a good gain. Give him about 5 yards. Bring up third down and 2 for the Cats.
Nice hole open by the Wildcat offensive line. Kenny gets through. Tried to explode, lost his footing, and was covered by Gary Pulford.
So Shenango on their first third down situation tonight. Third down at 2 with McCormick wide at the near side. Same formation with Iwaniko in the slot, and Iwaniko will go in motion to the far side of the field. Pitch it goes to Valenti. He's got a first down at the 50. Valenti inside Cornell territory to the 48-yard line. Stop made by number 20, Chris Cotter, and that'll be a Wildcat first down.
Looks like Coach Bonchevigo is going to try and establish the running game, just some simple running plays, see what he can do, try and move the ball down the field early on. They might see him open up that little pass over the middle for Rob Creasy in time.
5 minutes and 58 seconds on a rolling clock. And we won't be back here until a couple of weeks, and I think that's Rochester then, too. Shenango and Rochester. We'll be back here later on in the year. Fumble, handoff, fumble, ball's loose, and the Raiders have it, I do believe. A bad exchange, yep, coming up from the bottom of the pile with a football. Is number 66, and that's Chris Stone. The fumble recovery at the 48-yard line. Mark, didn't look like anybody had that ball that time. Looked like it hit maybe Valenti or one of the running backs, but that ball was loose from the very get-go.
DeCarbo got it cleanly from the center. However, I believe that the running backs were a little bit ahead of him, tried to make the save, and bounced it off Valenti's hip, and the ball was loose, and Cornell recovers.
A receiver wide here on the near side. Leitner under center. Quick count. Leitner, he's going to go for the marbles. Got a man open. It is incomplete. In and out of the hands of Sam Smith, who got behind Chris Johnson. Smith had a step on Johnson, so head coach Will Ron Cohn was going for the jugular right after the turnover. But the pass is dropped by Smith. Should have caught that one, Mark.
Should have caught it.
Kind of turned the wrong way a little bit.
Ball might have been thrown just a hair behind him. Turned around the wrong way. Chris Johnson had at least a couple steps behind the wide receiver. And Johnson, only a sophomore, and Frank Bonchevigo not very happy.
Now you're going to learn by your mistakes. And Johnson, only a sophomore. Hand off it goes right up the middle. Stevenson, the bulk area, inside Cat territory. I believe it was Stevenson. Let's make sure. DeCarbo down there along with number 74 for Shenango. And that means Steve Trobeck. Stevenson picks up a couple of yards. Third down and 7, just under 5 minutes to play here in the first quarter. Who the Cats have next week? Do you know?
Cats,
I'll have to check the program.
We can see.
Third down and 7. Flanker to the near side is Sam Smith. Leitner to throw. Pass is caught. First down. That's Smith out of the backfield. From that flanker position inside the 35 to the 32-yard line. Again, well, they're picking on Chris Johnson's side right now.
Absolutely.
I think Frank's going to bring somebody else in, and I think it may be Robbie Creasy is going to come into the football game here.
Creasy was in last week as the safety moved to the sat out and move William back to the safety position. Creasy's going at the quarterback now.
Yeah. And you have Martwinski, too, on this side now. And Creasy's going to go as a safety, as you said, DeCarbo, into that cornerback spot. First down at 10 at the 35-yard line. Whistle, we're going to have some movement. Number 65, Mark Shirley, the left guard, moving up front. There, you do have the schedule now.
Right there.
Abbotsford, and then they open up September 20th against Wilmington. We'll be back here the 28th of this month when it is Rochester. We'll have the Laurel. In fact, we'll have three Shenango games in a row for you, Rochester, Laurel, because that's a Friday night. Newcastle plays at Shaler on the 5th of October on a afternoon. So we're going to pick up Shenango and Laurel for you, and then we'll be here with Shenango and Union. So we'll be absent for Wildcat football for 2 weeks, but then three straight weeks in a row we'll have Shenango High School football for you. First and 15, handoff right up the middle. It goes to Chris Cotter, crosses the 40, gets to about the 37-yard line before he's tripped up, jensing it on the stop.
And I'll tell you what, Kenny, Mark Shirley made up for his mistake on the motion penalty as he opened a big hole, and Connor was able to pick up about 3 or 4 yards on the play.
It was a perfect night, though, for football. This is ideal this evening. No wind and just nice, cool temperatures. Wideouts to both sides. back split behind Leitner, who passed for 1,500 yards a year ago. Leitner, a little drop play. Stevenson breaks a tackle. He's to the 40. Stevenson to the 35, to about the 34-yard line. One of the cats, Brian Perdue, missed the initial hit on the snap, number 22, Jimmy Valenti.
Perdue had the running back, Stevenson, in the backfield. Couldn't make the stop, but excellent pursuit by Valenti and some other Wildcats getting over to make the stop on the sidelines.
Third down and 9 for Cornell. And, of course, the Wildcats have not stopped Cornell in this third down situation yet today.
That's right.
Smith wide to the far side. Cornell likes to use the motion. They send a lot of people in motion. And Connor again will go in motion from left to right. Leitner fakes the draw, looks, big pressure, gets away, and now he's finally sacked. Strohacker made the initial pursuit. He didn't make the tackle. Jensen came up on the stop along with, I do believe, number 64, Doug Peters, helped out too on that stop. But Strohacker got the initial pursuit. Jensen and, as we said, Peters in on the stop. Back deep to punt will be Mark Neely. Chris Johnson is back deep for Shenango, standing at about his own 10-yard line. High snap, good rush. And they're going to throw the flag, and they're going to call the roughing the kicker penalty against the Wildcats. And we have another flag, too. We've got two flags. We've got three flags.
You got at least three flags on the play. Let's see what happens here. There's going to be a couple different calls, I believe.
I think Shenango's been flagged for two calls.
A legal man
downfield for...
Let's see.
Maybe we have to do this all over.
Mm-hmm.
And offsetting penalties.
He's only talking to one of the Cornell captains, so I believe this is going to be a first down.
Okay, roughing the kicker against Shenango. And a first down for the Cornell Raiders. That is what you call shooting yourself in the foot there.
Mm-hmm.
So a costly penalty for the Wildcats will take the ball all the way down to the 25-yard line. I don't understand that. Why, when it was marked at the 45, do they get it at the 25, Mark? That's a 20-yard penalty.
20-yard penalty, and that's not right.
I like to see this button. Maybe you have to get a hold of Jeff Kirk, see where that ball was spotted last, and why the penalty was such. Pitch and go, Stevenson trying to get outside. Won't be able to do it. Nice hit. Alex Kenny, number 47, puts the pads of Stevenson, drops him for a couple of yard loss. It'll bring up a second out of 12, but a great hit by Stevenson on that play.
Check with Jeff. That ball was spotted on the 40-yard line, Ken.
Oh, okay, so that was right then, a 15-yard penalty. We'll take it to the 25. So it'll bring up a second down at 12. Kenny, though, had a great play, and Cornell's really not been able to run the ball that effectively. I've done a great job, though, through the air. Receivers of both sides. Connor in motion here to the near side. Pitch, Stevenson looking for some room. Stevenson trying to get outside. Breaks a couple of tackles on his feet to the 20 before he's wrapped up by Rob Creasy of the Shenango Wildcats, along with number 40 in the football game, Chris Riley, another sophomore for Frank Bongiovingo.
I'll tell you what, Ken, also an excellent play by Vincent Martwinski. Came up and forced Stevenson just a little bit further outside than I think he wanted to go, and then Valenti and Creasy come over and finished off the play.
Third down and 5. Receivers to both sides. Neely tight at right end. Backs are split. Connor in motion to the far side. Leitner quick drop pass over the middle. Incomplete and almost picked up by one of the Cats. Robbie Creasy almost picked that up. Pass was intended for Neely coming out of the backfield, so we see that Leitner and head coach Will Ronco love that quick drop, Mark.
Absolutely, and I'll tell you what, since the Wildcats have made the adjustment in the pass defense, in the defensive backfield, the pass defense has tightened up just a little bit. This might be Shenango's best combination of defensive backs.
Yeah, we see Martwinski and DeCarbo on both corners with Creasy as the safety. Shenango with the four linebackers. Fourth down and 5. Big play here for the Cat defense. Leitner whistle. We've got some movement. We've got some movement by Cornell. This will go against the Raiders and bring up a fourth and 10 if they elect to go for it from there. I believe it was a legal procedure. Yeah, one of the guards pulled out too quick, and it might have been Shirley again who pulled out too quick and wanted to move towards the right side there from left to right, Shirley, to try to give some protection to quarterback Paul Leitner. Looks like he was going to roll to that side.
I think that's exactly right, Kent. And saw a couple wide receivers headed over to that side as well, so he's probably going to throw that rollout pass to the far side of the field.
Number 51 coming into the football game. That is Carmen D'Alessandro, 5'9", senior. Fourth down and 10, 47 on the running clock. Smith wide to the far side. Baxter split, quick count. Leitner a throw. He's got Smith open on the far sideline, but incomplete. He had Smith open, but Leitner with a bad pass went out of bounds. Officials time, 39 to go in the quarter. 8-0 our score. Cornell now this one, 1280 WKSJ. 39 seconds to go in the first quarter. McCormick split wide to the near side. Handoff, it goes up the middle. Ketty getting very little yardage. And it appeared that almost one of the Raiders had a grab. I guess it was the helmet because it was the face mask. They would have called the penalty. Mark Neely in on the stop along with Sam Verrid for the Cornell Raiders. That might have been our last play of the quarter. And Shenango finds themselves down as they did last week, although the Wildcats did score first against Western Beaver. McCormick wide to the near side. Iowa Deco in the slot to the right. 6 seconds ago, they'll get this play off and some movement up front by number 70, Sam Vera, the 5'11", 235-pound senior. So that'll march off 5 yards and bring the Cats up with second down and short yardage. It'll be a second and three.
Might see the Cats try another running play here, maybe go with that counter play with Valeni coming off the from the wing back position and see if maybe they can pick up first down and a little bit bigger gain.
Second down and three, and that will be the end of the first quarter of play here from Glen Pop Johnson Field. 8-0 Cornell. We'll take this time out on Lawrence County Sports Leader, 1280 WKSC. And welcome back here to Glen Pop Johnson Field. Shenango High School football in the area's leader in live local sports play-by-play coverage, 1280 WKSC Newcastle. With yours truly, Ken Labovia, Mark Shaws. We retreated some excellent wings before the ball game from the good folks, Cindy Lou from Galliano's Pizzeria, huh?
Absolutely, and missed out on the pizza, but got the wings that excellent, very good, very good.
I'm going to get that Wednesday. DeCarpo under center, handoff. Ketty bounces off a couple of Raiders. Will be stopped just short of a first down. 65, Mark Shirley in on the stop. Whistle and...
And I believe a couple...
They're caught. They got their face mask cut. One of the Raiders and one of the Wildcats have their face mask cut. 72 for Shenango Brian Perdue. And one of the Raiders, I guess that's what you call really playing it close, huh? Kind of humorous, both players kind of chuckling about it. Bring up a third down and short yardage, but we had some breaded wings and some hot wings. I had to go out and get a couple of pops after those hot wings. Excellent stuff.
Good stuff, too, and I encourage everyone to go out and try some.
You got to talk to Mr. Augustine. He promised us one, and we were really going to pig out here tonight. Mm-hmm. Third down and short. DeCarbo option. Pitch. Iowa Deco. First down. Ronnie leaps over one of the Raiders and is down at the 37-yard line. So it'll be a first down for the Shenango Wildcats. What we do, of course, all our great sponsors do patronize all our fine sponsors during our football broadcast all season long here on 1280 WKSD with the good folks like from Galliano's and also Augustine's and Jamison Health Systems and Roger DeCarbo, as well as Central Heating and Plumbing, Spencer's and Rockies. All our fine sponsors, we do appreciate their help throughout the year. My mouth's still burning. Wide out to the far side. Iowa Deco in motion to the near side. DeCarbo, handoff, Kenny's got some room. He crosses the 40, 45, out to the 46 before he's tripped up by number 35, Craig Pulford, but not before about an 8-yard pickup. Well, Shenango's been able to move the ball on occasion here tonight and again on the ground being successful.
And as I said earlier in the first quarter, I thought I was going to see more of Alex Ketty this evening, and Ketty has picked up some nice yardage so far in the game. A nice run there, an 8-yard pickup.
You didn't tell your partner in crime we still have some of those wings left.
No, I didn't, as a matter of fact.
Because we're killing those at halftime.
Because they'd be gone if he had them.
McCormick wide to the far side. DeCarbo, handoff. Ketty bounces off of one of the Raiders. Very close to a first down, but maybe just short. Mark says maybe the length of the football, 66 Cristonian on the stop. They're going to call for a measurement, but it's short. Now, you don't even have to measure, Rev. It's short. It's third down. Yeah, there we go. I'm going to bring another ball in. I'll bring up third down in short yardage situation. It'll be interesting to see, Mark, what the Cats elect to do in a third down situation. Last time they ran the option with DeCarbo. And DeCarbo's only run that option once tonight. We haven't seen William run the football himself yet. Wide out to the far side. They're going to go right up the middle to Kenny Weber. First down leaks over a couple of Raiders. He'll get the ball close to midfield before he's tripped up by number 52, and that being Sean Madonna, 5'8", 185-pound senior. And we'll call it a first and 10 from midfield.
Tell you what, Ken, it's one thing the Raiders have not done on this drive. They have not stopped that play up the middle with Kenny, and you're going to see Kenny some more on this drive. I'll guarantee that.
McCormick wide to the far side. Ioannicou on the slot to the right. DeCarbo on a long count, trying to draw the Raiders offside, maybe. Carbo on the option. Pitch it goes. Valeni breaks one tackle. Excellent play, though, staying home on that for the Raiders. That time being the quarterback, Paul Leitner. Leitner doing an excellent job on that option as Kenny was tripped up after maybe a yard gain.
Leitner came up, but did not fight for the run fake with Keddie going through the middle. A pitch out to Valeni, and Valeni gets just the yard on the play.
Second down and 9. Cats trail at 8-0, but have a nice drive going here. McCormick wide on the near side. Ioannicou slot to the left. DeCarbo, play action, looking, rolls, looks, wants a throw, got a man wide open. McCormick to the 15, to the 10, down to the 7-yard line. Robbie Creasy. Rob Creasy on the catch for the Chenango Wildcats. William DeCarbo and Creasy hooking up for a big gain of over 40 yards, of about 41 yards.
About a pickup of 44 yards. Ken, Rob Stevenson, the quarterback, did not rotate over as Creasy went out, split to the outside, and he did not rotate over. Creasy had at least 5 steps on Stevenson, but Stevenson's quickness was able to catch up to Rob, and Rob unable to get into the end zone.
Yeah, Robbie doesn't have to slow up for that football. That's a touchdown. Creasy wide to the far side, slot man to the right. Been calling Creasy McCormick all night. Hand up Valeni to the 5. Valeni into the end zone. Touchdown, Chenango. Nice play at some great blocking, Mark, up front. Walczak, Purdue, Fiola. Some excellent blocking on an offensive line opening up a huge hole. We were able to see that as Valeni just waltzed in the end zone from 7 yards out.
Valeni waltzed in the end zone, as you said. Great blocking by the offensive line of the Chenango Wildcats. And one of the Raiders is having some equipment problems. And, excellent run by Jim Valeni, as well as Valeni got through the hole, was able to cut to the outside for a little bit, and got it into the end zone for a nice touchdown run.
So the Wildcats see if they decide to go for the 2 points and tie this ball game up. Litzinger, the injured Raider. And the Cats going to go for the deuce. Down 8-6 to Carbo under center. Creasy wide to the far side. William looks, rolls, wants to throw. In trouble, throws as he's falling down, and it's caught by Kenny. What a play by both DeCarbo and Alex Kenny. William falling to the ground, Mark, as he was in, was able to get the ball away, and then Kenny making a leaping grab for the 2-point conversion. We're tied.
William got the pressure on the rollout, threw the ball. As he was falling down, he was, matter of fact, if it had been the NFL, he'd probably been down in the grass. Alex Kenny with a juggling catch, leaped in, up into the air, made the catch. A nice play for Alex Kenny and William DeCarbo, and we're tied up at 8 with 8:39 to play in the first half.
Excellent play. Of course, the big play in that, the 42-yard pass play from DeCarbo to Rob Creasy, setting up that touchdown. But we saw a good one a week ago, and it's been an excellent first half. Very few mistakes in this football game. We had the one turnover by Chenango, but that's been it. Good football game. Walczak has it teed up. Stevenson back deep.
7-yard touchdown run from Jim Valeni, and then a nice conversion pass for the Wildcats, tied up at 8.
Walczak, good kick here to the near side. That'll be Leitner at his 15. Leitner to the 20. Leitner looking for some room, trying up the middle, and he gets hit and stopped short of the 25-yard line. Good hit by the Wildcats. Chris Johnson down there in on the stop for Chenango. So first and 10 for the Cornell Raiders, and see now that Chenango defense could pick up some of that momentum, Mark, and go maybe three plays out here for the Cats.
Be nice. Raiders starting in Fairfield position at their own 24-yard line. Chenango defense going to have to rise to the task. And folks, real quick, if you're wondering why Paul Leitner is running back kicks for the Raiders, it's because they only have 28 players on their squad, so got to do more than one thing.
Leitner, handoff it goes, breaking a couple of tackles, getting across the 25 out to the 27-yard line.
And, Kenny, that was not Leitner quarterback on that last play, as number 10, Doug Ronkon, came in and took the snap, gave Leitner a break on that last play, and Ronco's still in there.
He appears to be all right. Leitner's talking with head coach Will Ronco. So Doug Roncone, yes it is, it's the coach's son, is the quarterback. Wide of the near side is Rudy. And again, we've got some equipment problems by one of the Cornell Raiders. Last ball carrier, by the way, that was Craig Pulford. So it looks like a couple of the starters from the offense aren't in there, because Stevenson's not in there now. There's been a couple of changes. Pulford handoff. Pulford bounces off a couple of cats. Will be stopped short of the 30-yard line. And that Chenango defense starting to swarm to the ball, led by Ben Poser, the 5'11", 180-pound sophomore on that play.
Excellent play thus far in this drive for the Chenango Wildcats defense. They're stuffing the run, and we'll see what happens here on this third and five play.
Connor isn't in the ball game. Stevenson's not in the ball game, and neither is the quarterback Paul Leitner either. So some changes here. Third down and five. That's Pulford in motion here in the near side. Roncone flagged down. Wants to throw. It is incomplete, and Martwinski almost picked it up. Vincent Martwinski almost had the interception. Penalty flag on the play. I think we're going to see illegal motion here against the Raiders, Mark. So the Cat defense coming up. Yep, legal motion. That, of course, will be declined.
Absolutely. Boy. I believe one of the Raiders' backs in motion turned upfield too soon.
I don't understand the strategy from head coach Will Roncone, unless he just wants to see his offense playing some down, since it is a non-league ball game. But a lot of his starters, as we said, Stevenson, Connor, Smith, along with Paul Leitner, not in that last series, had a whole new backfield.
Maybe we just wanted to go with the backfield there. Doug Roncone's used to, as far as who he would be playing with, probably as the second team.
All right. Back in punt formation is Mark Neely. Good snap. High floating kick. And it's going to hit at the 50. Take a cat bounce. Still rolling and finally down at the 43. Officials time. We're tied at 8. Now this in 1280 WKSU.
On Lawrence County Sports Leader, 1280 WKST.
Right now, Central Heating and Plumbing is featuring the energy-efficient Pulse Gas Furnace. The Pulse can help you cut your energy bills almost in half because it boasts a 95% efficiency rating. That means you get 96 cents worth of heat out of every energy dollar. Plus, the heat exchanger of Lennox Pulse is backed by a lifetime limited warranty. Financing is available. Call Central Heating and Plumbing for a free estimate. It's quality for you in every direction when you call Central Heating and Plumbing in Newcastle. That's Central Heating and Plumbing, Newcastle.
There was, you had a situation where Stevenson came in, and also Creasy also pushed off as well, and it does go against the defense.
As there was talk while we were away on that break, DeCarbo tried to hit Creasy deep once again. Good coverage. Creasy was pushed, and they called defensive pass interference, but there was contact both ways. I think the best thing on that may have been not even a flag at all, huh?
I think that probably would have been a best call, and I believe...
But although two of the officials did call it, though.
Mm-hmm.
Wide out to the near side again is Creasy. It's a first and 10 for Chenango. Momentum on their side of the 28-yard line. Slot man to the left. Maloney goes in motion from left to right. DeCarbo. Pitch, Iwaniko. Ronnie breaks a couple of tackles on the 25. Iwaniko inside the 20-yard line for Chenango. And Iwaniko very close to another Wildcat first down. Again, close to 10 yards on the play, just short. So that'll bring up second down and very short yardage here for the Wildcats, as they now continue to move the football and have Cornell kind of playing on their heels a little bit.
maybe just a little bit. And I'll tell you what, on that last play with Iwaniko getting the deep pitch, the Raiders linebackers did not pursue the play at all, as Iwaniko ran for at least 6 yards before he was even touched.
Second and short. Iwaniko in motion from right to left. DeCarbo, handoff up the middle. Kenny first down, Kenny to the 10. Kenny fumbled the ball. Fumbled the ball, and Cornell might have come up with it or did it go out of bounds. Nope, Cornell has it. Kenny had the ball inside the 10-yard line and copped it up. One of the Raiders is injured, and that ball's going to be inside the 5-yard line to about the 4. Alex Kenny looked like maybe he was easily inside the 10-yard line when he coughed up the football, and the Raiders recover.
Kenny was in the clear, had it, looked like he was going to go into the end zone for a touchdown. Looked like one of the Raiders got a hand in and knocked the ball loose, and was recovered by the Raiders deep in the at the far corner of the field. The Raiders very poor field position. They'll start off inside their 5-yard line.
One of the Raiders injured. Might have just gotten winded. 6 minutes even to go, and we will take a break while they're attending to the injured Raider. 8-8 our score. Let's take this time on 1280 WKST.
WKST. Hi, football fans. This is Chad. Score a touchdown by calling Galliano's Pizzeria.
Okay. All right, here we are back. Leitner to throw the football. Looks. Going to throw it deep here to the near sideline, way over the head of the intended receiver. And that was intended for Sam Smith. Vincent Martwinski on the coverage. That time, Leitner just dropped back and kind of threw a floater mark here to the near sideline, hoping maybe for a pass interference or a possible catch from Sam Smith.
I think that's what he was looking for, but I will say one thing. Excellent coverage by Vincent Martwinski on the play, as Martwinski got himself between the receiver and the ball, and it was an excellent coverage by the Wildcats, something we haven't seen this far on the night.
Now, costly turnover by Kenny, but it's second out of 10 from the 3-yard line. See what the Wildcat defense can do here. Leitner, handoff. Stevenson bounces off a couple of cats, gets across the 5 to about the 6. Good hit. Purdue down there along with, Jason Strickland also in on the stop.
Jason Triplett.
Triplett, I'm sorry.
Nice play. Seeing some new folks in the lineup for the Shenango Wildcats on the defensive line.
As we said, Jason Triplett entering the ball game. Wide out here to the near side. Leitner, quick count, looking. Has a man open on the near sideline. It is incomplete. Should have been caught. Neely had that, and it would have been enough for a first down if he came up with a catch. Well, that was just in and out of Neely's hands, and he should have came up with a football that time. He gets up slowly. Check that. That was intended for Sam Smith, but Smith had that football. Excellent pass from Leitner, and he just dropped the football.
I think he might have heard some footsteps, too, as Vincent Martwinski was coming in just ready to deliver the hit as well, so he might have heard the footsteps on that play.
Neely standing in his own end zone. Chris Johnson standing at the 35. Good snap. Nice high kick. Johnson's going to watch it hit. And this time take a Cornell bounce. Oh, one of the Wildcats plastered. That was Vincent Martwinski plastered one of the Raiders on that far side. So excellent field position here for the Shenango Wildcats deep into Cornell Raider territory at about the 33-yard line. First and 10 from there for Shenango.
First and 10. And I'll tell you what, did see a couple of the Cornell coaches took exception to that hit by Vincent Martwinski. But looked like a good hit from here, and officiating crew thought so as well. See what the Wildcats can do here. Try and put the ball in the end zone once again.
Tied at 8. Definitely Shenango in the second quarter has dominated play. Creasy wide on the near side. Valenti in motion from left to right. Hand off. Kenny breaks a couple of tackles at the 30. Still on his feet. Kenny inside the 25. Inside the 20-yard line before he's tripped up right there. And he did cough up the football, but after he hit the ground, so what does Frank Bonjovingo do right after Kenny makes a big turnover? Gets it right back in his hands.
Shows confidence in the junior running back, Alex Kenny. Kenny can be a great game breaker at times. We saw him break a game against Monaco wide open last year with his runs up the middle just like that. And see Frank Bonjovingo probably go back to Kenny here in this next series.
Kenny and Valenti this time behind DeCarbo. That's going to be Kenny again. No pass. It is incomplete. It almost intercepted. It was tipped up in the air. Neely had his hands on it. Leitner dove and tried to pick it off, but not doing so. So the pass goes incomplete on a second, on a first and 10. It'll bring up a second and 10 on the 18-yard line with 4 and a quarter left to go here in the first half.
And we see Dennis Klingensmith into the game. He's a 6'2 junior for Shenango as one of the receivers for the Wildcats.
Creasy wide to the far side. Slot man to the right. DeCarbo, play action, looks rolling to the near side. William is going to keep it, is going to be dragged down. And Neely in on the stop. So that may be even a loss of about a yard, or let's call it no gain. I'll bring up a third at 18. It looked like William was a little bit indecisive, Mark, on what exactly he wanted to do on the play.
Well, I'll tell you what, William was indecisive, and I think that was caused by excellent coverage by the safety, Paul Leitner, as he went over and got Klingensmith. He was, William was looking for Klingensmith, threw it right around the goal line, and was forced to keep the football and lost the yard on the play.
Creasy wide to the far side, third down and at 9. They did pick up a yard. Handoff, Kenny up the middle. He'll get a couple of yards. That's it, maybe two. As a stop made by number 51 on the play, and that is D'Alessandro. Fourth and 8, let's call it fourth and 7 for the Wildcats.
Fourth and 7.
DeCarbo gets the play from head coach Frank Bongiovingo.
Tell you what, Kenny, on this fourth and 7 play at the 16-yard line, they have 3 timeouts left. Might not have been a bad idea for coach Bongiovingo maybe to take the timeout and get a good play here.
Fourth down situation, a fourth and 7. DeCarbo fakes the handoff, looking, wants to throw. It is caught! Touchdown, Robbie Creasy, and a great catch. Creasy outleaped number 23 on the play, Rob Stevenson, a 16-yard touchdown. DeCarbo to Creasy, but an excellent grab by Rob Creasy.
And as we said last week, when you have an end such as Rob Creasy, who's 6'4", and he's going up against a 5'9 defensive back in Rob Stevenson. Stevenson had excellent coverage. He just got out, jumped for the football by Rob Creasy. Creasy, an excellent catch. Catch in the end zone, and a good pass by William DeCarbo. If Creasy doesn't catch it, it's just an incomplete pass.
Excellent job, too, by the offensive line, giving DeCarbo time to throw that football. Walczak has it teed up for the PAT. Good snap. Spot is down. Kick is up. Plenty of distance, and it's true. 3 minutes, 3 seconds ago in the first half. Shenango 15, Cornell 8. Now this timeout on 1280 WKS2. Last week we saw Shenango score first and a Western Beaver take over. Just a reverse tonight.
Cornell got on the board first. Shenango coming back with 2 quick touchdowns.
Leitner with a kickoff on about the 18 to the 20 to the 25. He's to the 30. Crosses the 30 out to about the 33-yard line. Chris Johnson down there along with number 61, Phil Park, 5'11", 170-pound sophomore for the Shenango Wildcats. And let's see, we're going to see Leitner come out at quarterback this time. So we just saw Doug Roncone at one series and a new backfield, too, that one series for head coach Will Roncone. Under 3 minutes to go. Mark Neely split wide on the near side. Man in motion, that is Connor here from left to right. Leitner on the option. Leitner's going to keep it. He's to the 35, to the 40, crosses the 40 to the 41-yard line. And he's dragged down after a gain of about 6 yards by Alex Ketty. Bring up a second and 4. 2 timeouts left for Cornell.
Right, as they burn one on that 2-point conversion. And I'll tell you what, Kenny, that Leitner might have been better served to pitch the ball to Stevenson. He picked up 6, but I think if he'd have pitched it to Stevenson, he would have got the first down.
Receivers to both sides. Connor again in motion here to the near sideline. Pitch, Stevenson has some room to the 40. Great tackle. Alex Kenny may pick up a yard, but Kenny made a great tackle. If he doesn't, Stevenson's going to probably pick up the first down, if not more, but a great play. Alex Kenny coming from the outside and making a great tackle.
Kenny came all the way across the field to make the play. An excellent pursuit by Alex Kenny, and Shenango has gotten excellent pursuit all night as we see Cornell has called a timeout.
Third down and 2 situation for the Raiders. Again this afternoon, the Westminster Titans came up a winner on the road.
17-10 against West Virginia Wesleyan. As we said a little bit earlier, Gene Nicholson picking up his first win as a head coach, and wish our best to the Westminster Titans all season long. See if get them into the Division II playoffs.
I don't know what that ended up as a final being. Jackie Sherrill's club at Texas. Receivers of both sides. Third down at 2 with a minute 58 to go. Connors in motion on the far sideline. Leitner, pitch, Stevenson looking for some room, 40. Ooh, very close to first down, looked like he picked it up. Stopped short just of the 45-yard line. And they may have to measure this, but I think he got enough for that one.
He got the first down.
That'll be a first down, so I'd imagine now with that first down, only one timeout left, we're going to see Leitner probably go to the air here. Cats lead 15-8. Both bands will be performing at halftime. We'll update you on the news throughout the area. Wide out to the near side. That's Sam Smith. Leitner to throw. He wants Smith. Throws to the near side. Smith slips but catches the football inside Cat territory to the 48. Martwinski in on the coverage. That'll bring up a second down and short yardage. And here comes the quick offense by the Raiders.
Absolutely. And something you don't see in a high school team very often.
Three receivers, four receivers out on this pattern. Pass to the far side. Incomplete attempt for Neely. He can't hold on. That'll bring up a third down and three for Cornell.
That is something you just do not see in high school football, where the quarterback has two plays called and just races the line of scrimmage and everybody with him, and what will be called in college and in pros, of course, the two-minute offense.
We saw Steve Knight in there for the Wildcats on that last play, 5'7", 158-pound senior. So Frank using a lot of guys defensively tonight. Wide out to the far side. That's Smith flanked that way. Whistle. It's a movement up front against the Cornell Raiders. And Cornell a bit sloppy here in the second quarter. They looked awesome on that first drive, but since that, really have not seemed to put things together, seeming to be a bit out of sync.
Just a little bit. Matter of fact, Cornell has been out of sync ever since they had the change of quarterback in the second quarter where Doug Ronco came in and took over the helm, and Cornell has not moved the ball effectively since that point.
Minute 16 to play, 15-8. Shenango is on top. Third down and eight situation. Going to send receivers to both sides this time. Neely tight at right end. That's Stevenson in motion from right to left. Leitner to throw, does. Pass caught by Stevenson, fumble. Ball's loose, and the Wildcats, I do believe, have recovered the half. Shenango recovers the Stevenson fumble, and in on the recovery, number 64, Shenango, that being Mike Walczak. So Walczak comes up with a fumble recovery, first and 10 for the Wildcats at the 42-yard line. Shenango with all three of their timeouts left, and with a minute 7 to go.
Absolutely, and I'll tell you what, Jim Valeni came off the field injured on the play, but Valeni caused it all with excellent coverage and knocked the ball loose as well.
I think he might have hurt his hand. No, he must have got popped in the ribs. DeCarbo looks. DeCarbo throws. Caught Creasy. Wow, there was the old hook and lateral play. The Cats were going to use the hook and lateral play. Creasy made the catch at the 30, and Chris Johnson was following, and Robbie didn't get hit immediately. It was going to get flipped back to Chris Johnson.
Oh, there's no doubt about that. As the hook and lateral, Shenango has used that play effectively in the last few years, and that's a good play. Creasy with an excellent catch, and nice throw by DeCarbo as well.
So, that's not your car, is it? I have the arm to do it, and he has confidence in him. He thinks William is definitely has the arm to be able to carry this club. Creasy wide to the far side. Chris Johnson back into the football game. DeCarbo pumps once, looks, got a man wide open. Iwiko got it, 5, touchdown. Alrighty, Iwiko was so wide open. Could have caught a Coley, was so wide open over there. 30-yard touchdown. DeCarbo to Iwaniko, and there was a severe break in coverage there. A breakdown for the Raiders. 30-yard TD makes it 21-8.
And I'll tell you what, Kenny, between the Raiders linebackers did not go over to take Iwaniko coming out of the backfield, and you could see they were pointing fingers at each other. You were supposed to get him now. I was supposed to hit. And it ends up at a touchdown for Shenango.
It was a nice pattern. We saw Creasy do a post pattern, Mark, and they followed Creasy. And Iwaniko just kind of went up the sideline, and nobody was there. He went towards the corner of the end zone. He was wide open. He could have caught the ball and probably crawled to the end zone. Spot is down. Walczak on the extra point. It is up, and it's good. 35 to go. We'll keep it right here. 22-8 the score. So the Shenango Wildcats have exploded for three touchdowns after The Cornell Raiders took an 8-0 lead.
I'll tell you what, Kenny, Iwanico was so wide open, he could have ran to the parking lot in the elementary school and shut the lights off in that car.
Oh, my. He was. There couldn't have been anybody within about 5 yards of him.
No, there wasn't. And I'll tell you what, too. Cornell in the game films, if they saw last week's game, they probably saw that the Iwanico was really not used that much coming out of the backfield as a receiver. They did throw to Valeni and also Kreese, so everybody went with those two and left Iwanico wide open.
You know, there's great coaching, too, Mark, on Chenango's part, where the coaches upstairs probably talking to Frank, that probably said, hey, they're worried about Kreese making a couple of big catches. His size is 6'4", so they sent him down the middle of the field, and everybody followed him.
And I'll tell you what, that had to be the play, too, because a couple plays earlier, they tried to hook in lateral. Nobody was covering Scott Johnson, or Chris Johnson.
Short kick up front, caught at the 30-yard line to the 35-yard line. So the Raiders bring it out to close to the 40 with 29 seconds left now. Of course, when the chains move, the clock will start. The Wildcats' offense has looked great, but give credit to that defense, Mark. They were... Cornell kind of went through them like a little bit of Swiss cheese there for a while, and the Cats kind of shored things up and have played very good football since that opening drive.
Well, Frank rotated a couple people around, and they've gotten excellent pass coverage, and the run defense has been has done very well all night.
17-16 on a moving clock. Leitner wants to throw the ball, does here to the near side. Diving catch made by number 21, Sam Smith. See if Cornell uses that final timeout. 5-4, they may not get this play off. 3, they won't either. That's going to be it. That's the end of the first half here from Glen Pop Johnson Field in Chenango Township. Our score, the Chenango Wildcats 22, the Cornell Raiders 8. We'll be back right after this timeout of 1280 WKSD. Boy, this is fun. I enjoy doing games like this. 22-8 our score. Chenango on top of this football game. Be a big key here in the second half. As you said, Mark, we were talking at halftime, the fact that probably this first series, and you want to beat the heck out of that radio before this night's over. Very important for Cornell definitely is going to be defensively here in this first series of the second half, because the Cats really been able to do what they wanted to do with the football for the whole second quarter.
Absolutely, and we'll see what Cornell defense says here. They've got a rest at halftime, but we'll see what they can do. Chenango will get the ball back to start the third quarter, Ken.
Okay, ball's teed up. Valeni has it teed up. Short kick coming in the near side. It's still loose, though, and one of the Cats falls on top of it. And that ball was loose, off the side of the foot, kind of kicked by Leitner, and the recovery was made by number 21, Mike Christ. First and 10 for Chenango. How about that offense so far, doing a heck of a job?
Offensively for the Wildcats, of course, William DeCarba, the junior quarterback. Running backs, Jim Valeni, Juan Iwanico, and Alex Ketty. Tight end, Rob Creasy, and John McCormick, the senior split end. We'll get the offensive line after this play.
Different look here. Full house backfield for the Cats with a two tight end offense. Hand off, second back through, fumble. It's loose. DeCarba fell on top of it. DeCarba pops on top of it. That ball was loose, but William was able to fall on top of it and may pick up a yard or two in doing so.
I believe William knocked it off the hip of one in the running backs. I believe Alex Ketty on the play, and DeCarbo was able to pick up the bouncing football and get about a yard and a half out of it.
Second down and 8. DeCarbo under center. Hand off it goes, Ketty. He'll bull his way, still on his feet. Alex across the 45 to the 46, and he carried a couple of Raiders with him.
We know what kind of runner Alex Ketty is, as he carried number 66, Chris Stone, for about 2 yards. Pickup of about 5 on the play for Alex Ketty, and it's third and maybe a short 3 for the Wildcats.
Chenango on top, 22-8. Creasy wide to the near side. Iwanico in the slot to the right. DeCarbo on a 3rd and 3. William hands the ball off to Valeni. First down at the 50-yard line. So Jim Valeni picks up the first down. Greg Pulford in on the stop. So Valeni, who was just a little shaken up in that first half, no problem. Back in the lineup for the Cats as they pick up their 10th No, eighth first down of the night.
Eighth first down of the night. Hey, let's give credit to the Wildcat offensive line. Steve Krobak, it's a junior. Matt Fiola, a senior. Mike Walczak, a junior. And Brian Perdue, he's a senior. Just some of the members of the Wildcat offensive line.
Don't forget, well, Pirate Baseball after tonight's game. Bucks and the Dodgers in game three of their series, splitting the twin bill yesterday. Dodgers a half game up on the Braves. Check that. Actually, it's tied right now because Atlanta won earlier this afternoon. Cats break from the huddle. Here's that two tight end offense. Different look with a full house backfield. It's Iwaniko, Ketty, and Valeni. Hand off to Iwaniko. Rod breaks a tackle, spins 50, 45, 40. First down and run. What a run by Rod Iwaniko. Pulford in on the stop.
Shenango has two or three running backs, and Iwaniko, Ketty, and also Jim Valeni. They can't break tackles at times, and perfect running by Iwaniko there, just bowling his way for about 10 yards and another Wildcat first down. Wildcats moving the ball, keeping the clock moving, and trying to get it into the end zone and maybe get that touchdown that they need to maybe put this game just very close to being out of reach.
Yes, two tight end offense again with that full house backfield, and one of the Cats move. And
Dennis Klingensmith.
Yeah, Dennis Klingensmith, number 23. So, John McCormick isn't. John started this at the split end position last week, but it's Creasy this week with Klingensmith playing the tight end spot this week.
McCormick was in there to start the game, but they've blended this two tight end offense, as you said. And when they go to that look, you see Dennis Klingensmith in there. I believe Klingensmith might have just a little bit more size than McCormick.
Valeni out of the ball game. Chris Johnson replacing him. Looks like Jimmy maybe with a little bit of a cramp trying to stretch the legs out here on the near sideline. And off second back through Chris Johnson. Chris breaks a tackle. Fumble the football. And yes, Cornell has it. So Chris Johnson fumbled the football. And Cornell comes up with it. Number 23, Rob Stevenson with the football. Maybe, Mark, the break that the Raiders were looking for right there.
Absolutely. Forced a fumble as Johnson was carrying the football, trying to get maybe that little extra yardage, got a little bit of careless shifting the football, and Stevenson recovering it, and it'll be first and 10 for Cornell.
Smith wide of the far side. Paul Leitner, who passed for 1,500 yards under center. Connor motion from left to right. Leitner, pitch. Stevenson looking for some room. Kenny chases him down and makes the tackle. No gain on the play, maybe a loss of a half a yard. Alex Kenny in on the stop on that far sideline.
I'll tell you what, Ken, that deep pitch to Stevenson has not worked since about midway through the first quarter. Ketty has read that play every time, and it's just not going to work. So maybe we want to take that one out of the Raiders playbook.
Mike Strohecker coming out of the ball game here. Wide outs to both sides of the field. Leitner under center. Drops the throw, has time over the middle, caught with some room, with the football, knee lead to the 40, to the 30, to the 25, 20, flag on the play, it's going to go for a touchdown, but a flag on the play, it's going to be a clip. Oh, the Cornell coaching staff is hot.
I tell you what, it's not a clip. I believe what happened.
A push in the back.
That's what's going to be. One of the Raiders got his hands in on the block, and that's going to be the call.
And a great play. One of the Cats hit Neely as soon as he caught the football, but Neely just bounced off of him and raced down the sideline for the touchdown. They're going to call the clip, but basically, well, as Mark told you, it was a push in the back. And another flag. We're going to have an unsportsmanlike conduct penalty against the Cornell coaching staff.
No, this is going to be against one of the kids, Kenny. As number 66 for the Cornell Raiders, Chris Stone, I think, said nasty word to one of the officials, and I think that's going to be the call.
So. Now, see, here's what I don't understand now. The officials continue to talk. Let them talk. Just walk away from them.
Well, he probably wanted to know. So they sent the official over, and now being back, Judge Steve Fee, who did not throw the flag, trying to give an explanation to the official, to the coaching staff, rather, of what the call exactly was.
Okay.
And by the 30-yard penalty as well. What happened there, of course, the penalty marked off from the spot of the foul. So it took it back to the line, took it back, but where the spot was not enough for the first down. That's why we're second and 15.
Leitner hit as he throws, and incomplete. A host of cats right in there. Leading the way was number 73, Jason Triplett, with the pressure. Bring up third down and long. So if it wasn't for that second penalty, it still would have been a first down.
More than likely, it would have been a first down for the Raiders. And I'll tell you what, Ken, little thing of maybe not losing your control on the football field, and that's not a good sign for the Cornell Raiders.
Receivers of both sides on a third down and 15. Well, it was a great play by Neely. That could have changed his game around. Man in motion to the near side is Connor. Leitner, pitch, here to the near side. No, Leitner is running the football. It was Rod Cohn in the game at quarterback and pitched it to Leitner. He'll be stopped well short of a first down. Nice play for the Wildcats, I believe, by Jensen. I think it was.
Jensen was in there also. Chris Johnson as well in on that last play. And I'll tell you what, Ken, don't want to harp on this too much, but we saw the Raiders have a little bit of problem after the touchdown pass to Iwanika, and just not getting together, and very slow getting off the field as well are the Cornell Raiders.
Well, Wildcats looked like they may put a rush on. Now they drop back. High kick by Neely. Not that deep. Johnson fumbled it again. Cornell football. So Chris Johnson with a second fumble of the quarter, and Raiders have it at the 34-yard line.
Tell you what there, Ken. Chris Johnson did not call for the fair catch on that play. Johnson maybe should have looked like he was trying to take one step forward before he caught the football. Johnson should have put the hand up, make the call for the fair catch, and then just concentrate on catching the football. Gives the Wildcats good field position, but he fumbles it, and now the Raiders get the big break that they need.
First and 10 for the Raiders at the 34-yard line. Connor in motion. Leitner, pitch. Stevenson looking for some room, this time has it to the 30, gets outside, and finally gets knocked out of bounds, and it looks like another first down. And it will be, and Wildcat is shaken up on the far side. DeCarbo gets up slow, appears to be now okay. First and 10 for Cornell, that ball inside the 25-yard line to about the 23, so first and 10 there, Cornell. So a big costly turnover there by the Wildcats. That's if, of course, Cornell can capitalize on the mistake.
They get a cash in here if they want to get back in this football game.
Receivers to both sides. Man in motion, Connor from right to left. Catch showing blitz, and they do. Stevenson looks to cut it upfield. Bounces up, couple of cats, short yardage. Good initial pursuit first by Imran Iwaniko. Then coming up making the hit was Ben Poza. So good defensive work that time by the Chenango Wildcats. And I believe Cornell has called a timeout and a half. 6:45 to go in quarter number three. Chenango 22, Cornell 8. Let's take time on 1280 WKST. Wideouts to both sides. Ron Cohn in at the quarterback spot. Leitner is playing one of the halfback positions right now.
And we'll see what happens there.
Let's see if he doesn't maybe toss and throw a pass out of this formation, too. Fumble, Ron Cohn fumbled the snap. And that's what was going to happen. That's exactly what was taking place. The pitch was going to go to Leitner, and I think he was going to throw a pass out of that formation.
And I'll guarantee that, kid, because Sam Smith, the wingback, kind of just snuck out of the backfield and was looking to get himself into the flat about the 10-yard line for the pass, but not to be, as Ron Cohn cannot handle the snap.
Yeah, Ron Cohn a little too eager trying to get away from center there. It looked like he was going to pitch to Leitner. Leitner possibly throwing Ron Cohn out. Leitner back in behind center. Neely split flank wide to the far side. Baxter split 3rd and 9 at the 22. Leitner quick count, whistle flags. I don't know if they were set, Mark.
I don't think they were, Ken. I don't think
meaning
they were
Cornell.
Set. No, they weren't. As referee Fats Cabela is talking it over with his... with the Reverend Fats Cabela is talking over with his line. And no, it's going to go against Chenango. Chenango is offsides.
Oh, big penalty there. Set of a 3rd and 8. It brings up a 3rd and 3.
I'm going to tell you what. They were late getting set, but what might have happened, and I think what did happen on the play, is one of the Wildcats might have got his hand into the neutral zone. Of course, you cannot break the neutral zone in high school football. That's an automatic penalty.
3rd down. 4, Leitner to throw, does to the far sideline, passes caught by Neely. It looks like from here he's got a first down. Martwinski in on the snap. It balls inside the 15-yard line. Boy, that's close.
Good
first down, though.
Good coverage by Martwinski there, not letting the big play happen, but I'll tell you what, that's a good good pass for Cornell, picking up, just getting what they need for the first down. Now give them another series to try and put the ball into the end zone.
Again, Pirates Dodgers to follow. Tomorrow, Pirates Dodgers, Steelers Bills, and then the sports line, if you have one.
Oh, there'll be one.
Wide out here to the near side. Connor's in motion from right to left again. Hand off up the middle to Stevenson, bounces off a couple of cats, carries the mill inside the 10, maybe to the 9-yard line. Jensen along with number 72, Brian Perdue, in on the stop for the cats. Gain of 3, second and 7. If you get a long Pirate game, you won't have one, though.
We'll talk.
We'll get a good 3-hour, if you get a good 3-hour...
We'll have a short Steeler game, though, because Buffalo, of course, running the no-huddle offense.
Wide outs to both sides. Backs are split. Leitner might be changing a play here. Connor in motion to the near side. Here comes the pitch to Stevenson, looking to cut it up. Can't do it. Gets a couple on the play. Maybe to the 6, and that's it. Nice play, Kenny and Jensen. Boy, Jensen playing an outstanding game here tonight, Mark.
Andy Jensen was not in the game last week. He's a 5'9", 140-pound sophomore. And Jensen coming in at one of the linebacker positions this tonight. And excellent pursuit. Also, Alex Ketty got in there as well.
You know, this is two-down territory here for
Raiders.
No doubt about it. With 3rd and 6, the ball on the 7. Cornell seems to be a little confused here in this play. Wide flanker to the far side. Connor in motion left to right. Leitner, quick drop, pass, caught, touchdown. No, just short. I thought he was going to be in the end zone, but just short, right on the goal line. DeCarbo catching Neely just before he went into the end zone, but that's right on the goal line just about. A couple inches away, and that's it.
And it'll be a first down. Be first and goal for the Raiders at about the 1-yard line, so they'll have 4 cracks to get it in the end zone.
Boy, Shenango, their own worst enemy with 2 fumbles here in this quarter.
Goal line defense just saw Doug Venasco checking in again. 6-1, 240 for the Wildcats, and I think Shenango may have burned a timeout.
Well, I tell you what, that could be, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. They had 10 guys on the field. That's why they called it.
And number 40, Chris Riley, was just getting on the field. So
yep, that's what they had, 10 men. Assistant coach Frank Bongiovingo Jr. was not too happy there calling the timeout, somebody not in there. That could be a costly timeout. Wide out to the far side, and that is Sam Smith. Backs are split. Long count, Leitner, handoff. Stevenson, did he get in? Yes, he did. Touchdown, Raiders. Cuts it now to 22-14. 2-point conversion makes it 22-16, and very interesting.
Would be very interesting as well. Might want to see what, of course, the Raiders would go for the 2 here. Let's see what Shenango can do to stop them and try and keep them out of the end zone, keep this 8-point lead.
Of course, not to keep you in suspense until next Saturday. Who am I? Obviously, it was Frank Bongiovingo.
I don't know if we should have told him that, though. We might get some people mad at us.
It's just a flanker to the far side, and that being Smith. Leitner, see what they elect to do, whether pass or throw on this one. Leitner to drop, looks, has a man open. It's good. 2-point conversion, it's good. It's now a 6-point difference. It goes good to, it's to Sam Smith, number 21. Officials, I tell you what, we'll keep it right here. We'll take that break at the end of the quarter. We'll keep it right here. 3:55 to go, 22-16 our score. They're listening to 1280 WKSD Newcastle. I think I forgot to do that at the top of the hour. Keep the FCC happy with that.
It's always a good idea, by the way.
This coming Friday night, Newcastle High School football. Canes will look for numbers win 601. They'll travel to Mount Lebanon to take on Pittsburgh Central Catholic, who lost to Butler 9-7 last night. And that will be a tough ball game for the Canes in a stadium that they've had problems winning at in the past, down in Mount Lebanon. Pittsburgh Central Catholic playing their home games down there. Was it South Stadium they used to play? Central?
Yeah, it used to be South Stadium. Now they moved the games to Mount Lebanon. I think South Stadium kind of, they're starting to play some more Friday night games as far as the City League goes. So That's the reason for the change.
Leitner has it teed up. Chris Johnson is back again deep for the Cats along with Ronnie Iwadiko. Ball hits at the 25, rolls. It's at the 20. It's going to go out of bounds. It goes out of bounds. So that fortunate for the Cats because Cornell had some good coverage on that play. And Iwadiko picks it up. He's got nowhere to go. So it was fortunate that ball went out of bounds. So what, comes out to the 35 now?
Not anymore. They'll get the option of either. They can either take it where it went out. Looks to be about the 25-yard line, or they'll re-kick.
Mm-hmm. Imagine they'll have them re-kick it. And they will. I think the Cats are a little too deep on that and also too close together. If you look at Johnson and Iwadiko there, they're not that far apart. Now they spread out a little bit more than what they,
mm-hmm.
Yeah. They were just too close together last time. 3:55 to go here in the third quarter. And we've got one looks like it's going to go down to the wire just like last week between Shenango and Western Beaver, with the Golden Beavers pulling out a 19-14 win over the Cats. Shenango up by a couple of touchdowns on this one, but a couple of fumbles have proved to be constantly his quarter mark because of the fact Shenango on the previous series that they had the football was moving the football too in Raider territory.
Cats have moved the football, but costly turnover by Chris Johnson, and another Johnson fumble on a punt.
Leitner, another short kick. Ball hits, Johnson fills it at the 25, Johnson at 30, slips and falls. Chris Johnson at the 32-yard line. A game right now that he'll want to forget at this particular point. Well, now the Cat defense, even if they do not put any points on the board here, Mark, if they could run about 5-6 minutes off the clock,
mm-hmm.
would be advantageous to Shenango.
But as we said, the Cats have moved the ball pretty well when they've had it in this ball game tonight. And we'll see what happens here. Want to move the ball, try and keep it on the ground as much as possible, and just keep picking up first downs and run some time off the clock.
Creasy, split wide, right, hand off. Valenti has some room to the 35. Jimmy trying to get outside. He won't be able to do it. Won't be able to get on the outside. It's Stevenson right there, but Valenti will pick up good yardage here on first down for the Cats of about 5-6 yards. We'll call it a gain of 5, second and 5 for Shenango. So good first down play there by the Cats.
And Valenti down once again, but they're doing some movement with the leg, and I believe Valenti has that reoccurring cramp problem. He hasn't quite got over that yet. I tell you what, though, Jim Valenti had a nice pickup there, tried to turn it to the outside, and it looked like he gave up about a yard on the play, trying to make the cut to the outside, so maybe we're not an advised thing to do.
3 minutes and 22 seconds left to play in the third quarter. If you just joined us, it's been an exciting one with Cornell jumping out on top, taking an 8-0 lead, and then Shenango scoring three straight touchdowns to go up 22-8, and all of those touchdowns by Shenango, by the way, in that second quarter of play. Cornell has answered with a touchdown of their own in this quarter to cut the lead to 22-16, so the two-point conversion has been the difference in this one.
As Jim Valenti is up and he's okay, trying to put get some of the feeling back into that leg just a little bit. And Shenango out of the huddle once again, ready to go. Second and 5 at the 37.
DeCarbo under center, Creasy wide to the near side. Iwadiko in motion from right to left. DeCarbo long count. Little mix up in the backfield, but handoff. Another fumble. Cornell with it. Kenny Putt lost the football that time, and Cornell with it. Oh, my. The Cats with their third turnover of the quarter and their fourth in the ball game.
Tell you what, Kenny got through the line of scrimmage, then got stood up by number 42, Aaron Bates, and the ball just got another big hit. Ball popped loose. Leitner recovered it for the Raiders, and puts Cornell in good field position once again.
Receivers to both sides. Don't be surprised if Leitner tries to go up top. He's tried it once before, and Johnson is on Smith here on the near side to keep it on the ground. Oh, dude, Stevenson, and he gets popped. Kenny down there along with number 40, and that being Chris Riley, the sophomore. But Frank's got some good young players in his squad, but a great hit that time by Kenny and Riley.
That's right, Chris Riley in the ball game for the Shenango Wildcats. And also Alex Kenny once again sniffing out that deep pitch play to Stevenson. And that play still hasn't worked since the beginning of the first quarter.
Set flank wide to the far side. Leitner drops back to pass, looks, wants a sideline pattern, throws over the middle ball, tipped it incomplete. I think Riley tipped that ball for Shenango, and Martwinski had a chance to pick that off.
Chris Riley, a 5'10", 153-pound sophomore in the game, one of the linebacker spots for the Shenango Wildcats, and doing an excellent job thus far.
You got Jensen in the ballgame that's a sophomore. He's played Chris Johnson, sophomore. Martwinski, a sophomore. So some good young ball players here at Shenango. Receivers to both sides this time. Check that. Neely's going to, now they will have receivers wide to both sides. Whistle, movement up front by the Raiders. Well, now this has turned out to be a sloppy football game.
Mm-hmm. As the Shenango has had some problems, of course, turning the ball over, but the Wildcats have turned the ball over except for the punt on some excellent hits by the Raiders, and Cornell has just shot themselves in the foot. A couple of bad motion penalties, also two pass interference penalties in the first half, and a motion penalty, and then the unsportsmanlike conduct penalty as well that really did them in on their last drive.
Receivers of both sides. Smith flanked to the right. Connor again in motion from left to right. They like to use the motion. Leitner drops back, looking, still looking, in trouble, in pressure, looking, going to throw up field, incomplete. Good movement by Leitner, avoiding the pressure. Pass intended for Connor. It was in and out of his hands. Should have caught that one.
Excellent pressure by the Shenango Wildcats. Looks like Mike Walczak was in there, and a whole bunch of other of the Wildcats defensive line. Strohecker was also in there, and also good coverage, forcing the quarterback to roll out to Leitner to force the pass.
DeCarbo now back deep for Shenango. High short kick, and the Cats are just going to let this bounce. Takes a Shenango bounce, ball down right around the 30-yard line. 1:47 to go in the quarter, 22-16 the score. Shenango on top. Newcastle was last night, Ken. Again, Canes, Pittsburgh Central Catholic next week. The following week, it'll only be a single game also, with the Canes traveling to Katanning to take on Armstrong Central. And then it'll be a weekend doubleheader with Newcastle and North Allegheny at Taggart Stadium. And then it'll be Shenango and Rochester. So How about those two ball games for that weekend ahead for you on our schedule? Creasy wide on the near side, back split. And a little counter play, looking for some room with the football. 35-40, Iwaniko to the 45, all the way to the 49. Ronnie Iwaniko with a pickup of near 20 yards on the play. First down for Shenango, and we're going to have a Cornell Raider injured.
There is a Raider down on the field. And I'll tell you what, Ken, Valeni's out of the ball game right now, trying to get that leg together, but I'll tell you what, stuck Ron Iwaniko in that wing back position, shifted the backs around a little bit, and Iwaniko off that counter play, Mark Neely, the down Raider for Cornell, and Iwaniko, an excellent open field runner, had to play that little counter play, working well as it has for many seasons here at Shenango, and Iwaniko picks up the first down and about 15 in the process.
You think that's one Frank got from another coach in the area on that play?
Nah.
One that Ellen Jackson ran wild on last night, and it was one that I'm not, of course, bragging at all, but that call, I warned them. The coaches were sitting right next to me. Jackson lined up in that slot, and I said, look out for it. Boom, and there it was. And Jackson went in from 15 yards out for a touchdown. Five touchdowns, 225 yards. Gee, I wonder who the news is going to name as their athlete of the week.
Gee, I wonder.
Just some electrifying runs by Ellen Jackson last night. And some good play here tonight from William DeCarbo. Robbie Creasy making a couple of nice catches. So did Ronnie Iwaniko here tonight. DeCarbo wants to throw this time. Looking, going to throw deep. The Creasy got him out there. Incomplete. He had it in his hands on a flag on the play. Flag on the play. And I think we're going to see an interference call against Cornell.
Guaranteed, because what happened is when he moved, I'll tell you what, he did get tangled up with Creasy as Creasy tried to make a turn move, and that's a good call. It's against Creasy. I'll tell you what, that's not a good call. It looked like when the flag went in, Creasy went for the catch and it looked like Stevenson hit him. Stevenson touched him, if anything, but he calls it the other way. I'll tell you what, that's not a good call. And Steve Fee, the back judge, trying to explain it to Frankie Bonjovingo Jr., and I'll tell you what, that was not a good call. And it's going to bring up some first down in the...
It's going to be second and forever now for the Canes. Second at 25, ball resting on the 33-yard line. Creasy wide to the far side. William drops back to pass. He may tuck this one under, and he is. William to the 35. William, and he'll be stopped short of the 40-yard line, and he's blasted here on the near sideline by a host of Cornell Raiders. He does get out of bounds with 56 to go in the quarter.
And I'll tell you what, William got an excellent block on that rollout play by Mike Walczak, the right guard. Walczak getting out and burying one of the Cornell defensive backs. And if you saw 5'8", 178, and it looking like a big fire plug coming at you, you'd be worried too.
Of course, the back judge, I think, at any level of football, that's the toughest call. That's the toughest call
definitely.
That a back judge has to make, without a doubt. Creasy wide to the far side, Iwaniko in motion. DeCarbo looking, rolls, wants to pass, does, lofts one up. It is incomplete. Intended for Chris Johnson on the far side. Pass goes incomplete. That'll bring up fourth down, 51 seconds ago in the third quarter.
And I'll tell you what, Ken, that to put it in comparison, that pass interference as far as offense, defense, no call, it's the same as probably a block charge in basketball.
No, no
question
about it.
It's the most difficult call there is.
And because it's such a bang-bang call, too, some of them are not very obvious. I mean, when you're the umpire, of course, that's the most dangerous because you're liable to get run over. But, I mean, a hole is a hole, and that's an easy one to tell, but that pass interference, as you said, awfully tough. Iwaniko to punt the football. This is the first punt of the night, I think, for Shenango. Leitner catches it at the 31, 35, and is out of bounds at the 39-yard line. He's wrapped up here on the near sideline by a host of Cats.
And a down Shenango Wildcat once again, way back in the backfield.
Another cramp.
You know what? I don't see Jimmy Valeni on the sidelines there in the huddle. That might be Valeni down once again.
Yeah, because Ron Iwaniko, the punter, is on the sideline. 41 seconds ago, turn on. This is a long ball game now.
Yeah. No comment. You're going to get me in trouble.
Wide outs to both sides. Leitner, drop play, Stevenson fumble, it's loose, Shenango has it. Wildcats fall out of the 41-yard line.
I'll tell you what, Kenny, that play was doomed from the start, 77. That's Ben Poza coming up with the football for the Shenango Wildcats. That play was doomed from the beginning. Shenango stiffed it out. Chris Johnson was in there, Keddy was in there, and about three or four other Wildcats, along with Ben Poza, he picked up the football.
All right, first and 10 for the Cats of the 41. See if Shenango could punch this one in and go back up by two. Creasy wide on the near side.
They're going to let the clock run out and start it over in the fourth quarter. Good move, too. Take that 17 seconds off the clock. That's 17 less that Cornell has to score in the next quarter.
End of three, 22-16, Shenango. Let's take time at 1280 WKST.
Great summer, and...
Let's go, Bucks! Let's go, Bucks!
Iwaniko, the ball carrier, the 40 to 35. He's to the 30. He's to the 25, 20. 15, 10, 5. Touchdown, Roddy Iwaniko. 41-yard touchdown. It just might have broken the Raiders' back right there. Iwaniko with some nifty moves upfield. Races 41 yards of the Shenango Wildcats with their fourth touchdown of the evening. Go back up by two scores.
And gee, what play was that, kid? That was the counter play once again. Ron Iwaniko in the wing back position just takes the ball and just gets it through the middle and into the home free, and Iwaniko explodes for a touchdown for the Wildcats.
There's a big score there. Makes it 28-16.
To give him to Craig Pulford, the down Cornell Raider. Excellent ball game this evening here at Glen Park Johnson Field as the Wildcats have exploded here on the first play of the fourth quarter, putting it in the end zone. Ron Iwanico, a 41-yard run for the touchdown, and that might just do it for the Raiders.
So it will be definitely a delay of a few minutes here for Pulford.
That they might not be used to playing, and it's going to affect the Raiders, I think, a great deal in this last 11 minutes and 50 seconds of the ball game.
Stretch again coming out onto the field for Pulford. Go. His second touchdown of the evening. So it's been two big plays for Iwanico, a 30-yard pass he caught from William DeCarbo. And now Iwanico on a 41-yard run, as we told you, five carries and 82 yards. That's not too shabby.
And it's in the positions around because Iwanico has performed quite well in the wingback position for the Wildcats.
Looks like they may try to roll Pulford on the stretcher. I think they're going to probably bring the board out. And 28-16, our score. If you just joined us, Shenango just scored a touchdown, but on the touchdown run, Craig Pulford of Cornell injured on the play.
And they're bringing the collar and board now. Sit on the net.
So taking all the precautions, Pulford stood up, legs very wobbly, and he did take a few steps like this.
Absolutely.
So 22-8 our score, and with this delay and attending to Craig Pulford, we're going to... Okay, so they've decided, and probably done by the Cornell coaching staff.
I would think so, that Cornell will not continue here. So with 11:50 to play in our fourth and final quarter, that's the end of the football game.
I tell you what, Nancy, we'll take the remainder of our timeouts. Maybe you can go down and see the extent of the injury. So we're going to take a break. We'll be back here and see maybe possibly what happened to Craig Pulford. We'll be back after these messages in 1280 WKS2.
Hi, football fans. This is Jim.